We welcome you to another Sunday school lesson. Sunday school is a blessing and gift from God. By the end of this lesson, we will learn the symbolism of blood in the Old Testament in relation to Jesus' work on the cross. A covenant is a kind of promise. It's a promise that is secured by something more than verbal affirmation. We belong to the period of God's new covenant that was secured by the finished work of Christ. This new covenant replaced the old covenant that was established with animal sacrifices. Although there was no defect in the old covenant, God found something wrong with the people. The Old Testament sacrificial system did not provide the answer for sinful man's need for reconciliation with a holy God. It was only a temporary measure, entirely dependent on Christ's perfect sacrifice for fulfillment. Under the Old Covenant, sacrifices were offered repeatedly. Under the New Covenant, Christ's once-for-all sacrifice was enough. Our lesson comes from Hebrews chapter 9. This week's lesson deals with aspects of the New Covenant that Jesus Christ mediated. Our lesson begins with verse 11. And it says, "But when Christ came as high priest of the good things that are now already here, he went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not made with human hands, that is to say, is not a part of this creation." It is reasonable to conclude that these good things means the current and future blessings, given to those who by faith accept Christ's saving grace. The tabernacle of Moses was built with earthly and corruptible materials. The more perfect tabernacle that Christ's saving work creates within the hearts of the redeemed, is heavenly, incorruptible, and undefiled, and does not fade away. This was accomplished not by the flow of goats and calves' blood, but by the once and for all time shedding of the blood of Christ, which was far superior to earthly sacrifices. Today, we don't need an earthly tabernacle because Jesus himself is our tabernacle, giving us direct access to God. Verse 12 says, "He did not enter by means of the blood of goats and calves, but he entered the most holy place once for all by his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption." Every time the high priest went into the Holy of Holies, he took the blood of goats and calves with him to sprinkle on the ark. The goat's blood symbolized the cleansing of the people, and the calf's blood symbolized the cleansing of the priests. In contrast to the priest, Christ did not enter the same Holy of Holies; rather, he who knew no sin entered the true sanctuary above, the heavenly sanctuary, and offered up his own blood in the very presence of God in heaven. Our redemption is eternal because Jesus does not have to die again, and he has been appointed our high priest forever. Verses 13 and 14 say, "The blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean sanctify them so that they are outwardly clean. How much more then, will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death, so that we may serve the living God?" Verses 13 to 14 form one rhetorical question. The implied answer highlights the superiority of Christ's sacrifice over the sacrifices of animals. These animal sacrifices freed the outward man from ceremonial uncleanness, but they could do nothing for the inner man. So, the ashes and the sacrifices had no real value in themselves. Their value only came when the people obeyed God's commands. While animal sacrifices may have given worshippers the feeling of external cleansing, only the blood of Christ can purge our conscience and liberate us from the internal guilt of sin. Jesus was the perfect sacrifice, similar to the perfect animals that could not have any blemishes as required by the law. But this is where the similarities end. The fact that Jesus offered himself means that he willingly gave his life, as opposed to the animals which had no understanding of what was taking place when they were sacrificed. God's holy character demanded a perfect sacrifice in order to achieve reconciliation for us. The Spirit works, in and with Christ, making sure our redemption is secure and we, through faith in Christ, are set free to serve the living God. Christ is our Redeemer. Human nature wants to work for salvation, but that's not God's way. Ephesians 2:8-9. Verse 15 says, "For this reason Christ is the mediator of a new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance now that he has died as a ransom to set them free from the sins committed under the first covenant. Christ's death served two purposes. First, it was to redeem people, who were under the law of Moses from their transgressions against the first testament. They were saved the same way we are, by the blood of Christ. Notice that the death of Christ is the only basis of forgiveness for sin in any age. Second, the death of Jesus provided the means for those who come to Christ in the church age, to receive all that God has promised us. The possession of the land of Canaan was Israel's inheritance under the Old Covenant. Those who are saved under the New Covenant have the promise of eternal fellowship with God. The promises of the Old Covenant were mostly temporal, but the New Covenant is eternal. The Old Covenant was limited by man's obedience, so its promises were conditional. The New Covenant is unconditional and rests totally on Christ's obedience to his Father. Verses 16-17 say, in the case of a will, it is necessary to prove the death of the one who made it, because a will is in force only when somebody has died, it never takes effect while the one who made it is living. Verse 16 affirms the fact that a testament or a will is activated only after the death of the person who made the will. Verse 17 repeats the point that without the death of the person who makes the will has no force. In essence, this is the writer's way of illustrating the necessity of Christ's death. The inheritance referenced in verse 15 could not have been given and received by us without the death of Christ. Christ had to die in order for the new covenant to be put in force. Just as a will becomes valid after the death of the one who makes a will, so our eternal inheritance could only be received after the death of Christ. Verse 18 says, this is why even the first covenant was not put into effect without blood. Having argued that death must occur in order for a will to be put in force, the writer now states that just as blood was required under the Old Covenant, so also was blood required under the New Covenant. During the Old Covenant dedication ceremony there was blood, water, scarlet wool, and hyssop. The blood and water came from Jesus' body when a soldier pierced him in his side, John 19:34, a scarlet robe was put on Jesus, Matthew 27:28, hyssop was most likely the reed used like a sponge to give Jesus vinegar to drink, Matthew 27:48, John 19:29. This point will be reiterated in Hebrews 9:22, and almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood is no remission. Verse 19 says, when Moses had proclaimed every command of the law to all the people, he took the blood of calves, together with water, scarlet wool, and branches of hyssop, and sprinkled the scroll and all the people. The author continued to talk about the confirmation ceremony Moses led when the law was given. This was the purification ceremony describing the act by which Moses consecrated or cleansed the people. This was to bring them under the Old Covenant, to consecrate or set them apart as God's holy nation. The author of Hebrews wanted his readers to know that now in the church age, it is the blood of Jesus that sets believers apart as his followers. Verse 20 says, he said, this is the blood of the covenant, which God has commanded you to keep. Moses was saying to the people, this is the blood that marks the beginning of the agreement between you and God, the agreement God commanded me to make with you. Think about the difference between that old covenant and the new covenant we as believers now enjoy. We don't have to provide a sacrifice. God provided it for us. Hallelujah! In a sense, we can say that the first covenant didn't cost God anything since the Israelites provided the sacrifices. They probably dreaded the cost of the sacrificial animals. However, the new covenant sealed with Christ's blood cost God everything, but its benefits are ours. Verse 21 says, in the same way, he sprinkled with the blood both the tabernacle and everything used in its ceremonies. As part of the confirmation ceremony of the Old Covenant, we are also told that Moses sprinkled with blood both the structure as well as all the utensils used by the priests when they served in the tabernacle. These items also needed to be a part of this purification ceremony because they were being set apart for use in special service to the Lord. Verse 22 says, in fact, the law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood, and without the shedding of blood there is no forgiveness. Notice that the writer says nearly everything, not just all things. This was because there was one exception to this principle, in the case of very poor Israelites. They were permitted to bring an offering of flour in place of a blood sacrifice for a sin offering. Based on the principle he had just stated, the writer reinforced what Scripture declared, that without shedding of blood is no remission of sin, Leviticus 16:7-11. The literal meaning of remission is dismissing or sending away. The scapegoat being sent out into the wilderness is an excellent portrayal of remission. But the scapegoat does not portray the idea of total removal of sin without a trace. The only remedy for sin is the death of Jesus Christ. Key verse. The law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood, and without the shedding of blood there is no forgiveness. Hebrews 9:22. Under the Old Covenant, sacrificial blood was required to sanctify almost everything. Forgiveness for sins, in particular, was dependent on the death of an animal. Here, the writer makes it clear that the blood which was spilled in both the Old and New Covenants is necessary. Forgiveness from sin is not possible without it. Indeed, Jesus Christ's blood is the ultimate blood given in exchange for our souls that purifies us and makes atonement for our sin. Thought to remember. Christ's perfect sacrifice gives us access to God in the New Covenant. The sacrifice of Jesus Christ is a once-for-all, permanent, and completely effective solution to sin. The fact that Christ died for sin only once also means that his next arrival, in the future, will not be as a sacrifice, but as the final fulfillment of God's plan. Our lesson next week is entitled, Hearts United in Love. Our biblical reference is Colossians 2:1-15. We are truly glad you spent time to learn this week's lesson with us. We hope you are blessed and may share these with somebody else. We wish you can join us at the Cubao Church of Christ soon. Our congregation is a place to discover faith, find new friends, grow closer relationship with Christ and serve with each other's gifts. Thank you very much, have a great week, and God bless you always, dear brothers and sisters.